Hi, everybody. My name's Kyle Marsh, and I'm on the Identity and Network Access Division at Microsoft. Today, I want to talk about adding authentication to your application. So the first step you need to do as a developer to build on the Microsoft Identity platform and add authentication is you need to tell us that you're going to be trusting the Microsoft Identity platform. And the way you do that is by creating an application registration. This I like to think of as, what does the developer know about the application? So the developer knows how you're going to do authentication because of the type of application you're building, and therefore you know what settings will need to be made here. You'll know the type of APIs you're calling and the permissions you need to call those APIs. You'll know whether or not the configuration you need requires any client credentials and how those will be handled here as well. So this is all done in the app registration, and it tells us about what the developer knows about the application. Now, a couple of things you have to point out at the very beginning here is, first off, a display name for your application. That's pretty straightforward. But the second thing you have to tell us is, what are the supported account types for your application? Let me go through what that particular question is asking. So the easiest supported account type is something we refer to as a single-tenant application. What this means is the only users who can authenticate to your application are associated with the tenant where the application was registered. So this is great for line-of-business applications where the only users should come from your enterprise. Now, we have this application registration, but it's really not enough. We need more than that to really manage how this application is going to work in that single tenant. So what we need is another location, an enterprise app or service principal under the covers, so that IT can come and decide, for example, which users and groups are allowed to this application. They're the ones who are going to be granting consent for any resource access this application needed. And if, for example, they decide that this application is quite sensitive or there are other zero trust policies in the enterprise, they can assign things like require an MFA for this application. So the enterprise apps blade is how IT controls how any particular application works inside of that tenant. So the next supported account type is multi-tenant. What that means is any user who has an Azure Active Directory account will be able to sign into your application. If you want to restrict it to only a few tenants, then you need to apply that filtering yourself, because any user with an Azure Active Directory account can sign into an application that is designated as multi-tenant. Optionally, you can extend that multi-tenant nature to be including the Microsoft consumer accounts like Outlook.com, Skype.com, etc., and even limit it to only those Microsoft consumer accounts. But a multi-tenant application allows users from other tenants to sign into this application that's registered in your tenant. Now, we do still need to allow the IT departments in that other tenant to control how this application works in their tenant. So as soon as a user authenticates into your application, an additional service principal or enterprise app will be created in the home tenant of that user. And now the IT folks there could say, for example, apply their own conditional access policy. Or maybe in the Contoso tenant here, where there's just a user who signed into your application, maybe there they want marketing to use the application, where in a datum, sales is using the application. So this enterprise app or service principal controls how that application can work inside of the tenant where the service principal is, even though there is only ever one app registration for your application back in your home tenant. Now let's talk a little bit about how multi-tenant applications work. With a multi-tenant application, we provide what we refer to as our common endpoint. That simply means you ask Azure Active Directory, I don't know where my user might be coming from, I don't know what their tenant identity is, please sign in the user to their home tenant. The user enters their ID, we determine what tenant that is, And then we go ahead and ask that tenant to sign in the user, whether it's user A from A-Datum here or user B from Contoso. So my application that's registered in A-Datum here, when user A accesses my application, I should be allowing that user access to anything associated with A-Datum, but not Contoso. Similarly, if a user B from Contoso signs in, that user is limited to what is available to someone in the Contoso tenant. If I were to ask something like a resource for Microsoft Graph, it would come from that user's home tenant and that user's home tenant only. There's no need for any kind of invitation process here because the users are simply signing into your application as home users or native users in their home tenant. Now, this contrasts with our external identities or business-to-business, B2B model. In a B2B model, Contoso, or A-Datum here, wants to share some resources, some data, with a user from Contoso, and they want to share it with that user. One of the factors is that the user's coming from Contoso, so they're a user in a partner enterprise, for example. In that case, user A-Datum has to invite user B from Contoso to become a member, or participate, rather, in the A-Datum tenant, and that would be as a guest user. So we separate authentication from authorization. We authorize everything based on that guest user in A-Datum. So user B, the guest user, can access this particular A-Datum tenant data. Great. But when user B needs to authenticate into the A-Datum tenant, then Azure AD will send user B off to Contoso and say, please authenticate this user. They do whatever they need to authenticate in the Contoso tenant, maybe a password, username, MFA, for example. And then they tell A-Datum, yes, this is user B from Contoso. And A-Datum tenant turns around and tells your application, user B, the guest from Contoso, has signed into your application, and that user is allowed access maybe to this particular A-Datum tenant. We need an invitation process for this to work, and your application can't use the common endpoint to support guest users. Your application must sign into the A-Datum endpoint for a guest in the A-Datum tenant, and your application would need to sign into the Contoso tenant if you needed to sign any guests into the Contoso tenant. You can't use the common endpoint to support B2B or guest users. So let's take a look at how application registration works. And for this, we'll go over to our demo here. I'll start a new application registration. So this will be a client application for our video. You can use, obviously, what display name most makes sense to your users to help them understand what your application is or maybe what it does. And then I have to pick my supported account types, single tenant, multi-tenant, consumer accounts, etc. I'm going to go with the multi-tenant model here. And since the redirect URI says it's optional, I'll skip this for now, but I am going to have to fill that in because it's a very important component of my app registration. It's where Azure AD will send your tokens once whatever the transaction you're asking for has been done, and we will go ahead and send that token back to that registered endpoint. Your application, when it makes a request for the token, has to say, I want you to send the tokens to this address, and it has to be one of the addresses registered here in my tenant. So as I go through my registration, I would fill in branding. Key amongst these, I think, especially for something like a multi-tenant app, I'd want to make sure I do terms of service and privacy. I'd want to make sure this was coming from a verified publisher domain and not, for example, my onmicrosoft.com domain for my tenant. And finally, if I am an ISV and I want to really ease the ability of my application to be adopted by customers, I would say that this application is coming from a verified publisher, and I'd have my Microsoft Partner Network admin come and fill in this part to confirm that we are in fact a verified publisher publishing this application. The next thing I would want to make sure of doing, of course, is I have to set up what type of authentication I'm doing. We make this easier for developers by classifying it based on the type of application you're building. That really directly leads to the kind of registration elements we need to add. So for example, if I'm doing a single page application, we go to the specific information that's needed if you're doing that single page application. If you want to make it a little easier for yourself, you can jump to our Quick Start. Here in the Quick Start, not only are we saying we're building a single-page JavaScript application, but also what kind of framework, JavaScript framework, or maybe Blazor you're using to build that application. I'll pick the regular JavaScript code here. And now we'll tell you what needs to be filled in because you're a single-page JavaScript application. So for example, I need a redirect URI. I need an address for Azure AD to respond to your requests at. We'll make it a little easier to, with our the Quick Start can actually do the changes here on your app registration for you, so I'll do that. In this case, I'm doing a developer model, so I'm doing a local host. Before I move into production, of course, that will need to go into a secure HTTPS type address. And now if I wanted to easy get going, I can download this code sample, and it's already pre-configured for what I've set in my application registration. So that's a great way to get some code that you can use to get up and started, and we'll give you some directions here on what you need to do. So one other thing I want to point out here in the app registration is that you can come and tell us the type of application you're building. So we're building a single-page JavaScript application, and it is going to be calling some APIs eventually. And now what's nice is when I hit evaluate my application, we will give you guidance on how you're doing with your app registration versus best practices. So here you can see I'm done fine with things like picking up my redirect URI, but I still have work to do. I haven't told Azure AD what APIs I plan to call yet, and I said I was going to call some, nor as a multi-tenant app have I provided my terms of service or privacy or said it's coming from a verified publisher. We'll also give you hints along the way throughout your development lifecycle of things that you can do to make sure your application is secure and stays secure throughout your dev, test, release, monitor phases. So these are the steps I need to get going in order to have an app build on the Microsoft Identity Platform, and I start adding that authentication. My next step would be to look inside the Quick Start code I gave me that was given, and I will start adapting that into my code going on. Thank you very much. This has been a quick look at how you start by adding authentication to your application.